Scripture this morning is from Acts 17, verses 19 through 21. And he took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting, for you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new.
Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful that you've given us the old story, that it is something that we shouldn't take for granted, that though we've heard it, and some of us for many years, it's something that should be refreshed and made new in our hearts and our minds each and every day as we go forth in this world, that the gospel message might be something new that we proclaim to those who've not yet heard it, those who've been out in this world and have had so many things cluttering their world that they can't hear the still small voice which comes from you and tells of a great love that sent your Son to die for us upon that cross and be raised for our resurrection. Father, we pray that we might live this out in our lives and never let it grow old in our hearts. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen. So you're familiar with this particular picture that we have up here. It's a series that I've been doing since I've come in July, in talking about being in the world but not being of the world, talking about the Christians, the church's relationship to the world, and how it is that we can conduct ourselves in a very difficult world that we live in. And you may have noticed by this picture that there's on here something new. I mean, other than the title, something new, but there's a star that is up there. And so we want to talk about things today that are old that can become new again in our minds. Maybe you remember some of this. Maybe some of you have some of these hanging in your closet. I don't know. These bell bottoms from the 1970s that have come back in a clothing style called flares. Some of the younger people today might wear something like that, very similar to the bell bottoms of now 50 years ago. The 1970s were 50 years ago. That's a hard thing to think about. Ouch. What about hairstyles from the 1980s? We'll come up a decade here, and the mullet has just recently come back into fashion, into style. I have a nephew who is wearing his hair in a mullet right now, and he's only in 11th grade in high school, and I don't know. I just can't see it for myself, wanting to go back there. Or this one kind of surprised me, vinyl records. They are old, obviously, an older style. We went from 8-tracks and vinyl records to, you know, CDs and, you know, and now, you know, we had things on compact discs and it comes down to where we can get things from a streaming service now, all of our music. But vinyl records have made a comeback, and I know that this is on a lot of people's Christmas lists right now, is to get the old vinyl records and be able to have something that's old that has been made new again, once again. The word might be retro, or maybe it's vintage. Maybe you're not old, maybe you're just vintage. That's what it is. I heard somebody express that with so many things coming back in style, I can't wait until loyalty and morals become a trend again. Thinking that those things used to be in our culture, and now we're hoping that these things might come back. And so this is the first Sunday after Thanksgiving. And I know for a lot of people what that means is it's now Christmas time. And contrary to popular belief, this is not Della's house. I know she's watching with Don right now. Hi, Della. This is not Della's house. But what has happened with a celebration of the incarnation, or the Word becoming flesh and making His dwelling among us has become very, very cluttered. And for a lot of people, this is a very stressful season because suddenly it means that we're going to be exhausted. There's a lot of work to do. There's a lot of preparation to make. How are we going to find the time in order to get everything done that we need to do in the next month? And I really think what we've done is we have taken something that was new at one point. The incarnation of Christ was a new thing at one point in history. And throughout the generations, throughout the centuries, we have really begun to clutter it up with a lot of things, a lot of work. And so we have gotten used to the idea of this is old to us, and how is it that we can make it new again? How can we add lights? How can we add traditions? How can we add this or that or the other thing to make it new? But really it comes down to the incarnation, that Jesus had to be made like His brothers in every way, so that He could grow up and be hung on a cross for our sins, being the perfect sacrifice, and then being laid in a tomb 3 days later, being raised from the dead, and then ascend into heaven to be our intercessor at the right hand of God. We're taking that gospel message, that very simple gospel message that we can read about in the pages of Scripture, and we have cluttered it up so much throughout the years that it becomes very difficult to even explain it to anybody, the gospel, in its simplistic, simple form. But there was a time when the gospel message was new. Paul, speaking in the city of Athens, his hearers wanted to know what this gospel message was all about because it was something new. They wanted to hear what it was about, that Jesus died for us, for our sins, that He rose from the dead, and that we can get in on this salvation that God has made for us. How can we recapture the newness of the gospel message when it seems like it is so old? How can we make it new for another generation to hear that old, old story? In Athens, Paul proclaimed to the world something new. Now, as Paul was walking around the city of Athens, we can see that he was provoked in his spirit by all of the idolatry that he saw all around him. Athens, after all, was where the Acropolis was. It was where on every street corner there was a pagan god or goddess that was being worshipped. And it bothered Paul. It ought to bother us as we walk around this world and we see that there's so much idolatry going on around us. The worship of self, selfishness, the promotion of hobbies and celebrities and things that are pushed in our culture that act as these gods and goddesses around us. We ought to be provoked in our spirit as we see everything that is going on. And so he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" And others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities." They were a little confused about the message because it was something new, but they had a lot of questions. In a world in which they were so used to the same old gods and goddesses and idolatry and ways to worship these folks around them, they were intrigued by what Paul was saying, and they wanted to hear more. Notice that it wasn't new programs. It wasn't new ministries. It was uncluttered Christianity at its very core, the gospel message being preached in all of its simplicity, and he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection, verse 18 tells us. And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. And Paul knew this, and so he brought them something new. And what was that something new? Jesus and the resurrection. Very simple. Jesus and the resurrection. To them who were hearing it for the first time, it was something new. It was exciting. Let me know more about this. And so Paul starts from the common ground that they shared as he preached there in Athens to this crowd. And he starts by noticing their religious fervor. That even though it was misguided, even though they were worshiping these gods and goddesses that really weren't, he at least recognized that they were sincere in their worship. He found that common ground that we so often overlook as we jump right to how they've got it wrong about the gospel, about how they're living. He says, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God, what therefore you worship is unknown, this I proclaim to you.'" You see, they had this idea that, you know, in all the gods and goddesses that we've been worshiping, maybe we've missed one. And we don't want to offend anybody, so they set up this statue or place for this unknown God. And in, just in case we missed him or her, then we can go ahead and worship. So they gave sacrifices and everything that they would do to worship this unknown God. So Paul takes that common ground, and he proclaims Jesus and the resurrection. He proclaims the gospel. He proclaims something new to them. And so that might be a strategy that we, as we go out in the world, might try to find the common ground, might try to find the devotion to whatever it is they're devoted to out there, and say, you know, I can see you're really into this. Let me tell you what I'm really into. And maybe I can get you into the gospel message just as I am as well. He continues by as he gets into the gospel account itself, he begins to talk about repentance. And here in verse 30 to 32, "The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. But others said, "We will hear you again about this." This was something new to them, that the dead could be raised to life. And the reaction is what we might expect. Some mocked. And because some might mock us, that might be the reason why we don't proclaim Jesus and the resurrection to the world around us. But others were interested, and they wanted to hear Paul speak about this one more time. The good news is not old news, but now it is something new. My father-in-law has been getting the local news and Sentinel here. And, of course, he reads it the day it comes out, which is news probably in it that's already a day or so old by the time they get it to printing. And then he gives me the paper. So I'm reading news that is sometimes days old. But he also gets the paper from New York State, where we're from. And so he's got a friend up there who collects them a week at a time, and then he mails them all to my father-in-law, and so he will read them one day at a time. And so by the time I get the news from up in New York State, we're talking 1 to 2 weeks behind from when it really happened at that point. And that's sometimes how we think of the gospel message. This has been around since for like 2,000 years now. And so this is really, really old news. But did God intend for it to be really old news for us? In Acts chapter 2, as we see that first gospel sermon being preached by Peter on the day of Pentecost, we see him concluding here, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." That's speaking about us. "And with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation." You see, that was never meant to be news at the time. And then by the time we get to the year 2021, where we are now, that it's old news. Oh yeah, that's 2,000 years old. We don't need to really think about that very much anymore. No, it's meant to be something new, even for us, 21 centuries removed. But we think about it as old news. We think about the recipients of that news as not being very interested in what we have to say or what we have to declare to them. And so really we stop telling the news because we're maybe tired of telling it. But what happens when we stop telling the old, old story that is really something new? Matthew chapter 5 tells us, "You are salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house." You see, we who have heard the old, old story, for us at one time it was something new and we obeyed that gospel. We are the ones who have that light of the gospel in these jars of clay. We can't hide it under that bushel. No, we've got to set it on a stand for all to see by its light. We're what it says here, and a little bit later on, Mark chapter 2 writes about it. "No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made." You see, new cloth tends to shrink. And if we are that old garment and we're trying to put this something new on us, the gospel of Christ, then it's just going to tear away and not work very well. "And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins." In other words, new wine is going to expand. And if so, if we're trying to put something new into us, that might be old wineskins. The old, old story is old news and we're tired of telling it. Then it's going to burst us. We can't do that. We have to become new along with the new wine that's being put into us each and every day. And we haven't left this world. We can't escape this world here. And a lot of times we think of the church as a refuge from the world rather than headquarters to be sent out with that something new, that gospel message that the world so desperately needs to hear. And so here is the old, old story, that Jesus was God's own Son who took on flesh and was born, made like his brothers in every way. And he grew up sinless and went to the cross for us and died on that cross for our sins so that he could be raised from the dead and we too could share in that resurrection. And now he's there at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. There's the old, old story that needs to be made new for every generation. The truth of the gospel never changes, but the packaging may need to change for the generation that comes up. Here's the truth of the gospel that never changes. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel. The passage that Jim just read for us as we began the Lord's Supper here. Of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain, for I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And yet most of us in here are Generation X or Boomers, and we're trying to repackage this old, old story for Gen Y and Gen Z, who think differently and act differently and are out in the world around us living differently. And we have to make it relevant to them. How are we going to do that? Christians must proclaim to the world something new. There are so many old things that have been made new that the old, old story can be made new again. And yet we see a truth here being proclaimed in the Old Testament from Solomon, saying all things are full of weariness. A man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. What has been is what will be, and what has been done is what will be done. And there is nothing new under the sun. Is there a thing of which it is said, see, this is new? It has already been already in the ages before us. There's no remembrance of former things, nor will there be any remembrance of later things yet to be among those who come after. And yet, this was written centuries before God did do something new. And that something new is the gospel. But mankind has not changed. The ears still long to hear something new. The eyes still long to see that something new. And of the world around us, of those generations that don't know that gospel message, for them who have never obeyed the gospel, for them their itching ears will be filled with what the world offers them if we don't give them the truth of the gospel message. Paul writes about this to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. The world offers plenty of myths for them to listen to, and their ears and their eyes long to be satisfied. And what the world gives them does not satisfy, but what the truth is that we have to offer, that gospel message, truly will. And it's not as if the people out in the world has heard the gospel message, has examined it thoroughly and decided, nope, that's not for me. That's not where they are. The truth of it is that we've largely given up on telling the old, old story. He who captures souls is wise, but we've given up on that. This is the view of 36th Street from the main route that travels from Grand Central all the way up to the middle school. Is there any indication there at all of what goes on in that building? Is there any signage? Is there any clue that the gospel message, that the truth that can save them is being preached there, is being taught there, that there are people who worship there who love that truth of the old, old story? How would they know? By looking. I have a little fresher eyes than some of you because I've only been here since July. But maybe a few of these things have jumped out at me, and we need to do something about it. We've been talking about things like electronic sign, putting on the corner, right from that corner where the picture was taken on 34th and 6th. Maybe that's the start, but that's not enough. It's got to be the people who are here, who are going out with the message of something new and are telling the old, old story repackaged for those who need to hear it desperately. That's our job. Paul tells us this in Romans 10. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have not never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. That's our job. To tell the old, old story as something new to people who have never heard it before. If the gospel has become as cluttered to you as Christmas, then maybe we need to make it more about the gospel, the incarnation, the crucifixion, the burying, the resurrection, the intercession. There's the gospel message that we need to be preaching and telling the world. If you have never obeyed that gospel and you need to know what is involved, if you need to study with somebody to hear something new, then this is an opportunity for you to come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation. But perhaps there are those among us who have gotten tired of telling it, and you need that spirit within you renewed, the encouragement, the prayers of the church to help you. This also would be an opportunity to respond to the message as we stand and sing a song of invitation.